New Hollywood cinema was a very defined movement in Hollywood during the late 1960s and throughout the 1970s. The characteristics of this movement included a wave of many new young directors who wanted to challenge the classical style of filmmaking. This meant breaking social constructs, recasting heroes and villains, as well as new actors whose appeal was that they appeared like regular citizens rather than elite movie stars. In 1975, one young and upcoming director named Steven Spielberg made a movie called Jaws, which embodied many elements of New Hollywood cinema. The movement was essentially a backlash against conservatism and paved the way for filmmakers for decades to come. Another film that is totally antagonistic towards classical notions of storytelling and cinematography is Inglorious Bastards. It is not a typical war movie by any means and strays from many traditions common in the genre. The film is self-reflexive in nature and even revises the history of World War II. It was received well by many but was also harshly criticized. Some critics even claimed that the alternate historical timeline portrayed in the film was so egregious as to amount to Holocaust denial. It did not take long after the film industry was established for authoritarian regimes to seize upon its power for their own purposes. The power of film is a central theme in Inglorious Bastards. Joseph Goebbels, the minister of propaganda for the Nazi Party, appears throughout the film as he was in charge of the German film industry and was the second most powerful man in the party under Hitler himself. The opening scene references fairy tales with the phrase, "Once upon a time in Nazi-occupied France." This suggests that what we are about to see is a form of hyperreality and not an attempt at mimicking actuality itself. The dreamlike landscape and use of music also add to this. However, the brief moment of tranquility is interrupted when the SS arrive. There are also yellow English subtitles for the French, which is obviously for the audience. In addition to subtitles, there are other forms of text on screen. For instance, the introduction of Hugo Stiglitz, Joseph Goebbels, and the arrow that points out Bo Orman in the theater. These are all indications of self-reflexivity. There are other self-reflexive elements in the film as well, including the voiceovers done by Samuel L. Jackson introducing Hugo Stiglitz and describing the chemical properties of nitrate film. In a few scenes, the camera will pan out of one room and into another using an overhead shot that reveals the tops of the door and wall frame that indicates what is being shown is actually just a movie set. Film wields such immense power for many reasons, and Tarantino did not need to invent Goebbels' role in the picture. It is not a coincidence that he was the second most powerful man in the Nazi Party and also in charge of the film industry. In the film, Goebbels created the motion picture Stolz der Nation, called Nation's Pride in English, which features a German war hero who allegedly killed many enemy troops in battle. During the screening, Hitler praises the movie and calls it Goebbels' best. The Nazi audience in the theater could perhaps be allegoric to the audience watching Inglorious Bastards. We see them merely laughing and enjoying the film. They do not appear to be taking it very seriously and clearly are not searching for anything profound, which could perhaps be said about the majority of viewers watching Inglorious Bastards. But a majority is not all, and the films are very different. Nation's Pride clearly has a fascist aesthetic, whereas Inglorious Bastards embraces a multicultural internationalist position, and praises the individual. Although Nation's Pride features but one man, his achievements are for the good of his nation, not for himself. Lieutenant Aldo Raine's personal mission is not to win the war for the glory of America, but simply to kill Nazis. Overall, Inglorious Bastards is a work of art that glorifies itself and demonstrates the strength that a motion picture can have over society. In the last shot, after Lieutenant Raine carves Col Lander with the swastika, Brad Pitt and BJ Novak are crouching in front of the camera, and Pitt declares this one to be his masterpiece. One could almost not view this without seeing it as Tarantino patting himself on the back, but he has good reason to. Movies like Inglourious Basterds and others, especially earlier Tarantino flicks, would probably not be possible if it wasn't for the New Hollywood cinema movement.